earlier in Las Vegas, is in the field, as well as the most prolific bowler in the Senior Tour history, John Handegard. And don't forget about Gary Dickinson, the defending senior player of the past 2 years. Will the race tighten up, or will Evans pull away from the pack? The next 90 minutes may tell all. ESPN and the Professional Bowlers Association present the championship round finals of the Naples Senior Open. Inside Woodside Lanes, one of the most beautiful bowling centers in the entire country. We're coming to you from Naples, Florida. Hi, everybody. I'm Mike Durbin. Working with me once again, PBA, ABC Hall of Famer Earl Anthony. Earl, in our lead position, Tommy Evans. Number two position, John Handegard. Those two are really engaged in a great battle for Senior Player of the Year.
Well, no question about it, and it's going to come right down to the wire. There are only two events after this one left on the Senior Tour. And Tommy Evans, our leading player, has yet to lose from the number one position. He's 3-0, and he's averaged 248 in that lead position. But he's got his hands full. A guy that everybody considers maybe the best senior player ever to play the game, John Handegard, is in second place. He's the guy that dominates week after week. If he were to win today, he might be the favorite for Player of the Year. But waiting in the wings, maybe to be the spoiler. Two-time Player of the Year the last 2 years, Gary Dickinson. This guy can play. He's a millionaire on the bowling tour. He knows how to win.
And he knows how to throw a lot of strikes, as he's doing in practice. But in our opening match, we've got two-time winner Ron Winger taking on Las Vegas Senior Invitational winner Denny Torgerson. And there's the handshake. We're using lanes 23 and 24 from Woodside Lanes, and Denny Torgerson will be up first on lane 23. Well, Lighton leaves a two-pin. He really bowled great in Las Vegas a few weeks ago when he won that title there.
He did, and he bowled very well this week. He was up and down. He was very close to the lead for a while, got into some trouble, and of course, in the last couple of games, he bowled a 150 or 160 game the game before the position round, which really kept him toward the bottom of the top five.
Still had enough to come through the last couple games, though, and make the telecast. Huh?
Yeah, and he's got a unique style. We'll show you that later when you get a chance to see him on the right-hand lane.
Ron Winger from Tarzana, California. Had a lot of tough luck.
He always comes out fighting and grinding and going after you.
He did in Jackson, as you're going to analyze his style.
Well, take a look at this. Six steps, folks. Always the first two, then three. Finally gets the ball in motion, then the last three, very quick and short. Good slide, good balance here. He's very strong physically from the waist up. He can actually really force the ball through the first part of the lane. And Ron Winger isn't afraid of anybody. He'll go out there and get you, no matter who you are.
Well, he had a lot of trouble in Jackson carrying. He bowled a great game. Just left nothing but solid taps. So he'd like to come out and start carrying right away tonight. Seven pin was up there for a second.
It was, yeah. That ball's hitting very hard. We're going to take a look at the style of this young man, too, Denny Torgerson, when we get a chance, because he has a very unique release. He almost, we talked about it in Las Vegas, Mike, if you remember, almost like a frisbee with the bottom of the swing. Gets the ball outside of his hand, rotates it back in, see that? And that flip spin. And
well, didn't do it quite right that time as he leaves the 6-10.
Now we're going to get a look at later how he actually does it, but what we're going to do now is watch him switch balls, go after the spare here, stand way left on the approach. He won't throw that big spin hook on this one. He'll throw it hard and straight, just hit the pins.
Has it.
All right, here's a look at Denny Torgerson's style. Another lots of steps, but watch the ball. Ball goes straight down and back. Good position here. Now it folds out. You can see it coming out. You can't see his hand anymore because the ball's blocking it. And then the rotation around the side. Now we'll take a look at the release as he comes through. And I'll see the ball roll out away from his hand. Now at the bottom, as he brings it back in and rotates around the side, spins the ball, but still gets heavy roll on it.
Well, that seems like it'd be hard on your elbow and your wrist.
Well, hard, so hard, in my opinion, to be consistent with that release. But Denny's done it so much. And he's such a great athlete. He's outstanding athlete.
Basketball player, golfer, tennis player. He did all of those in high school and college.
And did them well.
Yeah, tremendously well.
I mean, he just didn't go out there and play. This guy could play with the best of them. And obviously, he can bowl with the best of the seniors. Tough spare here, 3-6-10. Just to get 3-6 with the ball.
Well, spares aren't going to get it done, though, Earl.
Well, it doesn't look that way. The scores have been reasonably good this week. Not extremely high, but very competitive. Took an average of 216 to make the top 24 players into the match play portion of the event. Took 210 average just to get a check, and that's like 55th spot, 54th spot. Scores were good, but they weren't ridiculous.
Ronnie with three in a row. He averaged 225 on this pair.
Take another look at that shot here. Right here, the position that Ronnie's in at the bottom, you can see the difference where the ball is on his hand as opposed to Denny Torgerson. And a different rotation on the ball, a little more end over end, higher roll, keeps the ball online longer, doesn't hook it quite as much.
You know, Ronnie was a great junior bowler in Southern California. I was teasing him
for a long time, great amateur.
That he used to throw a hook, you know.
Well, as we get older, Mike, you know, a lot of things change.
You want to elaborate on that? He carries the light hit.
Well, I think that was a little bit of an adjustment for that solid 7 he almost had in the second frame there.
Well, Ron Winger's off with 4 in a row as he carries this light hit to take a commanding 35-pin lead right now. We'll be back in just a minute to see if Denny can come. The Naples Senior Open is being brought to you by the Rude high-efficiency 90-plus gas furnace. You can rely on Rude. Well, it's the fourth frame. Denny Torgerson better get his act together and start striking, or Ron Winger's going to run off and leave him.
No question about it. He was throwing a lot of strikes in practice. Now he's to the point where maybe he over-practiced, Mike. A little more ball speed here. It looks a little better. More aggressive with that shot as opposed to the earlier ones where he looked like he was aiming the ball. That one he just went right out there aggressively, made a good shot.
Well, maybe a little jitters. You know, he hasn't been on television a long time.
Yeah, but you think he'd have some confidence because of the line, you know, in Vegas he was a winner. He did very well there. That should be good, bring back good memories.
There's his wife, Colleen.
Pretty blue eyes.
Well, the smile will get bigger if he can get a few strikes in a row.
That's right, and you can count on her being very nervous right now. That's the hardest job that you've got out here, being a wife and watching these guys trying to make strikes on television. Kind of overhit that one, looked like. Got out of time a little bit and really came around the side and tried to get more revolutions on the ball. Hooked early, 3-6-10 again. He's had this spare before, covered it quite well. Switch the ball, go cross lane at it. Hit a ball, doesn't hook as much.
This looks like he needs to, as he shoots the 3-6-10, get a little deeper on that lane 23 or something.
I think he's kind of lost his rhythm. It looks to me like he's just really not in good timing right now. And he was throwing the ball so well, as I mentioned in practice. Everything he threw almost was a strike. So.
Well, Ronnie working on 4 in a row.
Got a hurry.
It did.
Well, I think there's a man in the audience getting a little nervous right now.
The proprietor here, Pat Cinello.
Yeah. Tell him why, Mike.
Well, the reason why is that Woodside Lanes is going to provide a $25,000 bonus if one of our five finalists would happen to bowl 300. And Ron's almost halfway there as he gets a perfect strike.
That doesn't even look real. Looks like it's staged. It was so perfect.
Boy, hits a 1359 like it's supposed to hit, right?
This is the only lane he's had any doubts on. One was a little high, but almost had the solid 7, and the other was a little light, the wall shot.
For 6. A little off. Well, he's got that 3-6-10, too. There must be a place that lane reacts that way, huh?
I think he had a little approach problem there. It looked like he lost his balance a little at the foul line and didn't really get the ball off his hand as well as he'd like. Made him kind of come up short with the release, and that makes the ball always hook a little earlier.
cross lane at the 3-6-10, changing balls.
A lot of humidity here in Florida, and sometimes that'll create an approach problem. Here's a look at that first ball that got away from him. Watch him at the foul line now and see if he sticks a little bit. Kind of looks down at his foot after the release point. Here's the release. And the ball's gone. He knows it's not going to be a good shot, and you can see he's a little off balance here, falling off to the side. And just past that point is when he kind of looked down to see if he'd stuck a little bit.
Well, you can see he didn't have any trouble with Ron in the match play.
That's the best shot he's thrown right there. He's left the 10 pin. Got it a little deeper into the lane. Looks like he can switch bowling balls. Went with the ball, doesn't hook as much.
Well, he's running out of frames here. If he doesn't do something pretty quick, it's going to be
right.
Over. You know, you work so hard and you bowl so many games to get to this point.
Easy spare.
I talked to him about how good he thinks he can become.
Well, that's a tough question. I've worked awful hard. So we're hoping that this is the culmination of a lot of hard work and that it'll only get better.
Well, I think he's still in the process of developing that confidence that he really is among the elite.
He's always been kind of the kind of guy that doesn't display a lot of confidence. He's always quiet by nature, kind of stands outside the crowd, and just kind of fits in when it's necessary. And other than that, just kind of leave me alone, let me do my thing.
And he says, finally, I threw a good shot, Earl. Colleen says he threw a good shot, but he's still trailing right now. He's down by 43 pins. He's only got a few frames left. Can he stage a comeback? Well, we'll find out right after these messages. Football is the North Carolina Tar Heels going to Cardinal Stadium to take on the Louisville Cardinals. That's Thursday, September 21st, 8 o'clock Eastern Time. That's 5 on the coast. Ronnie trying to get back on track. And 2-4-5.
Well, I say this every time we get up here, but in bowling, it's never over. And this definitely isn't over yet, this match. Even though Denny Torgerson has struggled, he still has a possibility of a 234 game, if my math is correct. And Ron Winger going in a 234 pace right now, and he has to stay clean to shoot that.
And not an easy spare in the 2-4-5.
Little body English got the job done, and a deep breath and a sigh of relief from Ronnie.
Well, he hit every pin with the ball.
Yeah, 40-pin lead, 3 frames to play. But Denny Torgerson again, still in this match, so don't go away, folks. Another look at that spare shot. A lot of ball speed, and again, the basis of making spares is to hit them. Don't have to throw a big hook or a lot of ball. Just
reduce that angle by moving left.
That's
too.
Right. Play the percentages. All right, this has been his toughest lane so far, right here. Let's see what he can do. A little more ball speed, a little more room. Got it back.
Interesting pin reaction. The 5-8 kind of slid off to the side there.
All right, every strike obviously is necessary now for Denny Torgerson. He has to strike here and again in the ninth frame to put any pressure at all on Ron Winger.
Well, you tried the hard and straight, and it didn't work.
Well, he's got his hand.
6-7-10.
Yeah, you see the gesture he made at the foul line of throwing his right hand out to the right, his left hand out to the left. What he means by that is if he gets it started a little early, it hooks too much. If he gives it room, it doesn't come back. So, you know, maybe he can show off a little here and pick himself.
Ooh, almost, I'll tell you what. Well, a rough outing for Denny Torgerson.
But all in all, a good week. And two more events left. He's bowling well. And
it's his third telecast this year.
Good chance that he might even win one yet the rest of the year.
Oh,
yeah. Two events left.
As well as he's
won.
You're making that top five on a regular basis. You know, you're beating a lot of people, and you're bowling
right.
Real well.
Yeah, 173 of them this week bowled. 173 entries. So many entries, as a matter of fact, Mike, they had to use 2 different bowling centers for the qualifying.
Well, the proprietor here, Pat Stello, owns, I think, 5 centers in this area.
But they didn't spread them out over 5. This may have been a 2-week tournament.
They'd had a big pro-am, though.
They would have had a big pro-am, but the travel alone would have taken care of the prize money.
Well, another 6-10. He breaks the split up. Same hit that Denny had, but not the same result. Cross lane at the 6-10.
Right, we're bowling on synthetic lanes here. They're AMF synthetic lanes, AMF pins.
3 pound, 8 ounces. And the synthetic lane, very smooth surface.
Very pretty surface, too, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It's beautiful to look at. Aesthetically, it looks a lot better than the wood. It doesn't track up like the wood, doesn't take the pounding or get as beat up as you might say the heads on a wooden lane would get. So they're a little more consistent as far as getting the ball down the lane. It's a great look at them right there, how pretty they are.
They're tough, too. I know I took a ball peen hammer to a little section of one of those at one time. As he goes high again, it leaves the 4-7.
Glad it wasn't my ball.
They couldn't even dent it. Well, they wanted me to do that. I mean,
sure they did, Mike.
They did.
All proprietors want you to come in with a hammer and beat on their lanes.
No.
Right.
Wasn't on the lane. It was a little section that they gave me.
There's a good look at the head area, the first 15 feet where you see the arrows. That's the range finders or targets the players use to roll the ball over.
Makes the 4-7. Started fast, but kind of coasted in. Yeah, loped in here.
He better get lined up again because the guy coming on is awful strong. Gary Dickinson, the last 2 years, he's been player of the year on the senior tour, and he's looking to do it again. He's still in the hunt.
And Ronnie finishes with 232. 7 strikes in that game.
Denny Torgerson just never, ever got his motor running. The first 3 frames, he was completely lost. Finally got a strike in the 4th and thought he might get something going then, but he struggled really continuously through the match, Mike.
It's amazing how that out-of-the-wood shot carries, though.
Oh, yeah. So you always carry the count ball, too. You know, the one where it doesn't really matter. The last ball, when you
really
say, oh, to heck with it, I want out of here.
So the film ball always carries, really?
Well, for you.
I didn't know that.
You carried everything anyway.
Well, I needed to average 180.
180, yeah. Well, Denny worked hard all week, got a nice check for it. And what is 5th place, Mike?
$2,500.
Not a bad week's pay. Down here in Florida in the sunshine, and go out and lay on the beach for a couple of days and get ready for our next stop in St. Petersburg area, Sarasota.
And bank $2,500, huh?
Yeah.
And leaves the 4-9 there.
A little insult to injury. And Colleen doesn't look real happy, but
she'll feel a little better when he hands her that check.
What makes you so sure she's going to get that check? That's what I want to know.
You think she's not getting that check?
I think Denny's going to get it.
Okay, well, whatever you say. Denny finishes with 187. Well, that's the completion of match number 1. Ron Winger wins 232 to 187. When we come back, we need to concentrate on that elbow.
Formula One, the art of motor racing, only on ESPN.
For tonight's average builder, I want to talk about something that will help you put the ball on line with your target, help you to repeat shot after shot, build your average, and also something that Earl Anthony talks about almost every week on our ESPN telecast, and that is the position of my elbow or your elbow in the follow-through. Many times we hear Earl say that elbow should be right, pointing down toward the floor, and your arm almost in an L position as you let it go like this. Now, many times the momentum of your follow-through will carry on through up like this in some fashion, but at some point in the follow-through, that elbow is pointing to the floor. What this does is it helps put the arm on line with the target that I'm looking at. It also prevents me from sending the elbow out this way with the old chicken wing shot. It prevents me also from sending the follow-through out this way that can send the ball high or offline that way. Now let's take a look at the position of my elbow in a shot I threw. We can see letting go of the ball and the elbow pointing right down at the floor. Now the bowler on our telecast tonight that does this probably the best is the hottest player in our senior tour, and that's John Handegard. It seems like we use him as an illustration for all of these tips. But John's follow-through, as you see that arm so close to his body right there, and he comes right through here. The elbow is pointing down. The momentum of his arm took it on up higher like this, but he had the arm pointing right here. So remember, if you want to be able to put that arm on line with the target, repeat shot after shot, build that average, and do what Earl Anthony says, point that elbow to the floor in the follow-through. We'll see you again next Tuesday, 9 o'clock Eastern Time, in St. Petersburg, Clearwater. The Senior Open then, and of course, we'll have another average builder.
And in our opening match, Ron Winger 45-pin victory over Denny Torgerson. Well, waiting in the wings for him, very difficult opponent, Gary Dickinson, will get a few strikes against Ron. Don't go. Well, two veteran players here. Dickinson, I guess he likes lane 23 better because it's his choice. With he finishing higher in the standing, that means Winger going to start the match on lane 23.
Kind of interesting because it seemed to me that in the first match, Ron Winger had more trouble on the left-hand lane than he did on the right, even though he did start that match with the first five strikes. It looked like he just kind of lost his concentration toward the end when he felt like he had that match in his pocket.
Hard to sometimes turn it on and off, though.
Yeah, I would think that Gary would want him to finish on that lane if it's the one he's struggling the most on. I would rather have my opponent bowl his 10th frame on his tough lane than his 9th frame.
Well, when you bowl the matches, evidently Gary must be thinking that he wants to get his score posted first. Is that the way you approach it?
Or maybe he likes that left-hand lane the most, and he wants his 10th frame to be on it. Sometimes guys think that way rather than... See, I'm looking at it from the defensive point of view. Gary's looking at maybe from the aggressive and the way of going after, I'm just going to go out and shoot a score, try to beat me type thing. And if anybody can shoot a score, Gary Dickinson can do it. He's done it for a long time, and you can see there, 26 years throwing a ball as a professional. That's a long time.
I'll tell you what, though, and I used to watch him back at Meadowbrook Lanes in Fort Worth,
Texas. I used to watch him when I was a kid.
And he didn't look, yeah, right. He didn't look any different than he does now.
Look at that pin spin. Take a look at the game of a Hall of Famer here. Watch the arm swing especially. But the footwork is outstanding. The short first step, get the ball in motion with the second step. Look at the free swing, open the shoulder, square it up at the bottom of the swing. He's in perfect position there. And look at the long slide, bring the ball through the shoulders over the knee. Now that is Class A position, folks.
Look at that angle of that back.
And here's the result. When you do it right, this is what you get. You get the good breaks.
Really?
Really?
Is that true? I must have been doing it wrong all these times. Trying for a quick double.
A little love tap there, huh?
So he trips the four and love taps the 10. And
well, those are brand new AMF pins. They don't give you anything for free. You got to earn it. As I mentioned, these are 3-pound, 8-ounce pins, and they don't fall down if you just look at them. You got to roll it pretty good. Winger might get it put back on him the way he put it on Torgerson if he doesn't get going here.
Leaves the four pin.
Very quickly, let me give you folks an idea of what the tournament was like. This is a field of senior players of 173 entries. And the format, they bowled in two different bowling centers here in Naples, one called Beacon Bowl and the other Woodside Lanes is where we're having the televised finals right now. Half the field bowled 9 games at Beacon Bowl, the other half bowled at Woodside. Then they reversed it the next day, and they switched and bowled 9 games in the opposite center. So they had a total of 18 games of qualifying. The field then, based on total pins, was cut to the top 24 for match play. They bowled 3 8-game blocks of match play, and they carried their pin fall over, plus bonus pins. You see the top 5 bowlers here today.
Some of the scores right here. Had an average 216 to make the match play. Overall average 205, not bad.
Now 173 senior bowlers here in Florida.
See what kind of an adjustment. He looks like he moved in a little bit. He definitely did.
Well, he's a very talented player. You mentioned that he was just a great bowler down there in Southern California. Well, he brought that talent with him on the senior tour. And here's a look at the ball. It never really went into a heavy roll, but he got enough of the head pin to call the tickler. Hit him thin and watch him spin, huh? Now, here comes the man that could be the spoiler in this thing. When you look to Handegard and Evans on top.
He made an adjustment over that trip forward. Leaves the 2-4-5-8.
Surprises me. Gary did the same thing. He made a move there. He moved in, as you saw that. He moved in deeper on the lane with his feet, gave the ball more room. It never rolled back. He did the same thing in the position round this afternoon. I stood behind him and watched him bowl, and he had an opportunity actually to take the tournament lead. Ended up dropping from second to third. Tough spare here. Good cover. Take a look at the first ball again. Now watch the ball. As he gives it more room, Mike, you noticed he moved in, which he did. Now the ball is between third and fourth arrow, goes out, and never, he's in the oil too far. It never picks up the roll, never makes the arc back to the pocket. He made the same kind of adjustment in the position round this afternoon and couldn't carry the corner, kept leaving the 10 pin. And it surprised me because Gary generally goes with more loft and speed
which I think would have been the right move there rather than by moving on the lane.
Well, now you see why he wanted to finish on that lane. Ron Winger gluing in his finger grip right there. That's a little super glue he's squeezing in there.
These guys can do anything. He's doing surgery on his bowling ball. How about that? You know, we've got brain surgeons. We've got doctors, heart surgeons. I hope his finger doesn't stick on that super glue. Now he might throw this behind him into the crowd. What do you think?
Well, he might pull the finger holes right out of it, huh?
Or the finger right off the hand. Get ready to duck. Here it comes. Right back over the shoulder.
Trying for a double. Gave him room, but it hooked early and leaves a 6-7-10.
He quit on that ball at the bottom of the swing. He really didn't go through it as firmly as he has on other shots. The ball just rolled early on him. Got it out into the drier area of the lane. They have 39 feet of oil out there. It's a good surface to play on, a consistent surface. The players have bowled on the same exact condition all week long. They know exactly what to do. He's going to try to slide the 6-pin into the 7. Now, the problem is he gave it a chance right here. He did. He gave it a good chance.
I talked to him about whether the senior tour was vindication for his earlier performances.
Well, it's a second chance, Mike, and the pressure's off. It's a lot of fun out here. It's nice to be with the Webbers, the Gene Stutzes, the Glenn Allisons, and I'm just enjoying it, and I really like it out here. I'm having fun.
Well, he's not having a whole lot of fun right now. He's light high, leads to 2-4-5.
Had fun in the first game, but this one isn't nearly as much fun.
Well, he had fun the first five frames, and then he really did.
Yeah, he's struggled ever since. You're right. It's a good observation, Mike. Five strikes in a row, and then from that point on, the last five frames, and, of course, the first five of this one, he hasn't done a whole bunch. 2-4-5. Right at it, right down the left side. Good cover.
Gary Dickinson. 6'4", 180 pounds, both an ABC and PBA Hall of Famer. As you pointed out, has gone over the $1 million mark in career earnings.
Yeah, this would be interesting to see what he does with this shot. It looks like he's still inside, somewhere between third and fourth arrow with his target, probably. A little more roll on that one. He got it down in the lane earlier, and he got it. Well, that's a great adjustment there. I'm sure it was intentional. A guy like this doesn't let it fall off his hand for no reason at all. Gary got that ball in the lane a lot sooner than he normally does. Got it into an earlier roll, and this is the result. The ball rolled back to the pocket. You can see the pin action. Watch the head pin come all the way across the lane. It's kind of bounced around there, but it comes over and kicks the 6-pin, which is laying in the channel, into the 10. Boom.
Well, they're ganging up on that 10 pin. Mm. Although it needs ganged up on sometimes, right?
You know, the chance to really take a substantial lead early on in the match here.
Well, Gary Dickinson's come out red hot. He's leading by 41 pins right now. Ron Winger struggling, trying to find the rhythm again. We'll see if he can find it. We'll be back right after these messages. Don't go away. And Ron Winger in the sixth frame, working on a spare, trailing by over 40 pins. Needs to get something going.
More ball speed. Still couldn't keep it off the middle of the head pin. The big five. Grandma's teeth, is that what they used to call that? Or
No.
Grandpa's teeth.
That's the Greek church.
Oh, the Greek church.
That's the Greek church.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, if you call them by numbers, which you're supposed to, it's the 4-6-7-9-10. Here's another look at that shot. And I think Ronnie's pretty happy with this one. It just can't keep it left of the head pin. The ball just cuts through the middle of the pocket. Watch this. I thought he was going to get just enough of that 6-pin that creates some excitement. Standing room only crowd here, Mike.
Wednesday night baseball. We've got a doubleheader for you as the wild card race in the American League tightens up. Toronto against the Yankees, followed by Texas and Seattle, and a 6-10 by Ron Winger, who just can't keep it off the nose.
I know, he's really struggling, and it's just not like Ronnie to do that. He's having problems with that surface on that particular bowling ball, getting it down the lane. This wants to go early for him. I'm surprised he hasn't switched bowling balls, really. Seems to be the way to make adjustments nowadays. You've got so many bowling balls that the players carry as many as 30 or 40 with them at a time. and the adjustment they make, rather than changing releases or rotation, many times it just switch bowling balls.
Well, I think John Handegard would definitely have done something like that. Made a switch in that real quick.
Boy, what a great angle that is. And the 8-10 briefly, and Gary's reaction, oops.
Let me ask you a question here. What I see happening right here now is the players are faced with that overreaction there, that they get a little wide in hooks, and they get it in, and it's sliding. Now, how do you adjust to that? What's the best way?
That's why you and I are up here in the booth, Mike.
That we couldn't do it, huh?
Well, they have to parallel in with the oil, is my opinion. And, you know, with the new bowling balls, and the resin-reactive bowling balls, they actually collect the oil off the lane and absorb it into the surface of the ball, so it moves much more quickly. The lanes go through a transition period. There's a lot of oil to start with, as I mentioned. They double oil the heads, they spray them, they run the machine, they oil 39 feet. So it's down there a long ways, but it does dissipate quickly. Gary having no problem at all with the lane 23, as you mentioned. That's probably why he decided that he wanted Winger to start on that lane, because he wanted to finish on it.
Well, he's, you know, moving in against that oil was a right decision by a veteran player there.
No question about it. He got that lane 24. He got the ball down early, and it rolled up for him when he needed it to, and now he's kind of hanging in there right now.
And Ronnie's saying, what did I do? Why are you picking on me?
Well, Ronnie actually, you know, we can go back to the fact that in the first match against Denny Torgerson, he started with five strikes in a row, and he hasn't even been around the pocket since then. He's just struggled all the way.
Well, he's got a lot of circles, you know. He gets nine out on the 4-9. And, you know, when you get circles and X's, that's usually tit-tat-toe, and you don't score too well. But when you just get circles and no X's, then you really struggle. Ninth frame coming up.
Well, now you're just bowling for respect here. You're just trying to get the ball in the pocket.
Little pride here, yeah. Carry. No, it backed up and he left the bucket. Poor guy. I mean, it's going one way or the other.
Over under reaction, yeah. He just can't seem to get the ball to react the way he wants. And sometimes you lose all your confidence in this kind of a situation. You just want to get it over with.
He'd almost be better taking that spare ball he's using.
He's hoping for a power outage here, so nobody can see the remainder of this match.
Going right at the 2-4-5-8. And he's working it. He does not want to shoot lower than 150. Oh.
Oh, boy. When it rains, it pours. Here we go. He's such a good guy. You know, he's an easygoing guy and a good sport, great competitor. And he just can't do much about it. Gary Dickinson could be part of the problem. Gary puts pressure on you when you bowl Gary Dickinson.
I never could beat him, I'll tell you what.
There's a lot of guys can say that. Switch bowling balls there, looks like to me. And looking for a different ball reaction, getting ready to bowl John Handegard. So you're looking for every chance you can to get something going.
That's the ball he used on the left lane in the last frame.
That's right.
That shiny one there. So maybe he's thinking that get something to go a little straighter. He's got a big lead. He can experiment a little bit here. He's got about three or four of them out there. He could be his own team event right now.
Well, Gary having a good year, and he's surely not out of the Bowler of the Year race. You know, he's the last 2 years he's been Player of the Year on the Senior Tour. He's won a tournament this year, still in the hunt, especially if he can win this one today with two tournaments left. He could end up winning three events and be Player of the Year. Paul doesn't want to hit for him, does it? Doesn't seem like it does.
But it doesn't overreact either. And right now, if everybody else has the kind of reactions that Ron Winger's having.
John Handegard always finds a way to hit the pocket. He may not strike, but he finds a way to get the ball in the pocket area, one way or the other. And he's over there, I'll tell you what, I'll guarantee you, John Handegard is one of the hardest workers I've ever seen in the sport of bowling. He's over there right now paying attention. He knows what's going on over here, and he's already, in his mind, making the kind of adjustments that he thinks he has to make with his equipment. So he's getting ready to come over here and bowl.
Well, he switched back to that other ball that he started the match with right here. That one hits a little better for him. Well, he's getting a little Gary chant in the background.
Well,
here,
he's got a huge following here, and the people have been following Gary. He's such a nice guy. You know, he's several times been honored as Sportsmanship Award on the PBA Tour, the Steve Nagy Award, for being one of the favorite players among the other players.
Ronnie breaks down the bucket, claps his hands, and leaves just
the
5-8. Get that spare. He figures he can make the 5-8. The bucket, he didn't know. make this to get in the 140s.
Well, he can go out and lay on the beach with Denny Torgerson for a couple days.
And they can talk about the lace. Ron Winger, if he strikes, he's going to finish with 142. We'll be back with other finishers, our top 24 in this tournament, right after this. Stay with us. Be sure and stay tuned after the show tonight for Baseball Tonight. Hey, are the Red Sox going to finally pop the champagne corks and celebrate?
And don't forget to join us next week for our tournament in St. Petersburg, the St. Petersburg Clearwater Senior Open.
Our top 24. Other people made money here. Sixth place, Roger Workman, a good tournament. Just missed John Hersina. He shot a big game the last game to get the seventh.
That's right. He went around this guy, Tito Semez. He's one of the best players out here in the senior tour. Seven wins. And, of course, Pete Couture, this senior rookie, already has three top five finishes.
And in 10th place, Avery LeBlanc, runner-up in our senior championship. Gene Stuss, he just keeps rolling along.
Yeah, Dick Baker, the Illinois pro, was steady this week for 12th place. And Richard Beattie, the lefty from Detroit, seeking his third senior crown this week.
And a Hall of Famer, Dave Davis from nearby West Palm Beach. Barry Gurney, the defending champion here.
Derek Smith finished 16th. The Ohio player is looking for his first senior title in 17th. Rich Moores.
And in 8th place, Jim Long, very smooth player, and a new guy on the tour, Jim Service.
Hey, how about Vito D'Angelo? Angelo, the Bronx Bomber, had a great week, and of course, Jack Treloar continues to improve.
You get those tough names there. Shell Wilson, I can handle that. He's from Tampa, nearby, and Larry Gilder from Missouri.
And bringing up the bottom, but still making the match play, Bid Peoples rounded out the match play field. And the alternate, Ronald McDonald from Addison, Illinois.
And our final score, 224, and we won't mention with Ron Bold, but he did lose in this match, just by a couple pins here. In our next match, we've got two guys that are great going at each other. Handegard trying to become Player of the Year. Dickinson, he is Player of the Year. Stay tuned.
Season. The Yankees have some catching up to do in the wild card, and we'll look at the road ahead for the Rockies and Dodgers. Gary Miller and Roy Smalley at 10:30 Eastern.
John Handegard, he's going to start on lane 23. He was watching. He knows Dickinson had a little more trouble in the right lane. So he's going to make him finish over on the left lane. Oh, I got it just backwards, don't I, here? Oh, my goodness. Well, he got the seven pin out of there.
Well, John, as you can see, he did hit the pocket. He didn't carry, but he was during that position round this afternoon that I watched, he was amazing. He had the ball hitting the pocket from all kinds of conceivable angles, and the pins were kind of falling down like dominoes, and he'd have six pins in the pit and four laying on the deck. It was amazing, but he got them to fall. He always finds a way.
Well, you know, nowadays they've got all these different weight blocks in the ball and everything and pin positions, and you set it on the clock, and he is a master.
Oh, yeah, they talk about
setting that at
roll out and hook out and flare, and I thought they were, when he said flare, I thought they were talking about a pin or some kind. They've got all kinds of things that go on down there.
Dickinson, you could just see he wants to get out quick against Handegard, you know.
Yeah, and right there, you know, this is what happens. This is what I think a little bit of what happened to Ron Winger, even though he finished the first match poorly. I think when he got into the second match, he lacked confidence because he knew he had to bowl well against Gary Dickinson. The same thing applies to Dickinson against John Handegard. And it goes up the ladder. Tommy Evans yet to lose from that number one position.
That's amazing, you know, because most people complain, you know, about that number one position. He doesn't have any trouble with it at all, is he?
Not at all. We've got a guy who's been there three times. He's won all three times, averaging 248, which is pretty strong. That's probably why he's never been beat. It's pretty hard to beat 248.
248, yeah. Well, Gary on his favorite lane.
I wonder if we were to ask Tommy Evans which one of these guys he prefers to face in that championship match. He'd probably say neither one of them, you know, or either one. I don't care, probably. Knowing Tommy, he's a tough fighter. You know, he might just come out and say, I'll bowl either one of these guys. Two good shots by Gary Dickinson. The four pin on the right-hand lane, lane 24.
Well, I know that if it were me over there, that I would want to face Handegard.
I'd probably leave if I was
because, I mean, well, you know, if you beat Handegard, then you got a legitimate claim to Player of the Year.
That's a good point. I mean, that. That's good observation, Mike. Of course, if you beat the player of the year for the last 2 years, that's not bad.
That's not bad either. Handegard moving inside.
Price John trip. Doesn't create the speed that Gary does, so he has kind of a softer roll, a softer ball speed. And the ball just kind of goes down there lazily and rolls up to the pocket, and they all fall down.
Boy, you see, he's in close to the fourth arrow.
That's exactly what he did in the position round, and it's what he did, actually. During match play, the last three games, he moved in deep with this ball and shot 750 for the last three games of match play. Here's another look at it. Right around about the 19 board, look at the rotation. The good, strong, heavy roll on the end. The ball doesn't deflect at all. John Handegard lined up and ready.
ESPN as a service updates all the scores at 10, 30, and 50 past the hour, each and every hour.
He's playing this lane a little wider. He's out around the 16 board, getting the same basic ball reaction. John does one thing as good as anybody in the game has ever done, and that he gets to the foul line perfectly balanced, low on the knee, and reaches to the target. So he's very consistent with ball release and accuracy. He very seldom misses the target as far as getting through the head area on the same line time after time.
And now he's doing it with five steps. He did it before with four.
He's like you. He can do it with three, four, five, maybe just stand at the foul line like Count Gengler did. And Gary having a little problem. This seems like the guy that they can win a match and then they kind of hang around. Here's a chance for him to line up, though. This is the five pin. He can get lined up on this lane. He'll try a little different angle, see what kind of a ball reaction he gets, because this will be like a strike shot. So he gets a chance to try a little, something a little different, see how the ball rolls for him. You can see him. He's very really concentrating. He's not going to waste this easy spare. He's going to work on it.
Well, as he makes the five pin, I had a chance to talk to him earlier to evaluate 1995.
About a year ago, I started struggling with my game because I had tendonitis in the elbow, and my doctor at home told me it's about 80% back to where it should be as of right now. I feel like I'm finally getting my game back together this week, and it's the first time I really felt comfortable throwing a ball in almost a year.
So that's why he hasn't been quite as good. Just won one title this year. So.
Well, as good as this guy is, and at 80%, he beats most of the people.
To get started on.
I like the way Gary is, he's like he's a contrast at the bottom. He has a contrast in his release. It's kind of interesting to watch. And here's a good look at the pin action. Watch the hip pin go to the wall, creates all the damage, comes back, kicks out the four and the seven.
How many pins are on that deck?
Well, there's 10 to start with. There's 15 now.
Handegard's
just going to hang in there and keep hitting that hole. Hope they fall down like that.
Slow motion strike there.
Remember how everybody else had a problem with their hitting the pocket? This guy just doesn't ever seem to miss it. Look at the stance now. Watch the knee bend start as he gets going here. He starts getting lower and lower. A good free arm swing. Look at the knee starting to bend. The head steady. The long chase the ball follow through. And look at the balance. Absolutely perfect.
And at elbow at the floor.
Right. And look at the rotation. And the good pin action.
Just enough to tilt that five.
Yep. But don't want to hurt him. Those pins have to last another match or so.
But it's three in a row.
I think he likes this lane the best. The way he's getting a better ball reaction, I think, on lane 23.
Ooh, a little four-pin action there. He says, okay, all right. I can take this other ball. I can go cross lane at the four-pin, and most of the time I'll make it.
I'm making bets on this one. John never takes anything for granted. He takes his time and works on every shot.
Nancy Worth, John's fiance. Seems like she's on every week, too. It's because John's here all the time.
That's right.
Gary Dickinson. 299 left a 7 pin, I understand. Trying for a double that he desperately needs right now.
Ball's just a little late making the turn back to the pocket, and it's not picking up a heavy roll. It's got more of an end-over-end roll. He needs either to get a little deeper so he can get more oil and go more direct, or he has to go around the side of the ball for more side rotation rather than the end-over-end roll you see here. See the ball deflect? rolls almost between the 9 and the 10 pin. That's too much deflection.
Well, let me ask you a question. Then, if he moves deeper, won't the ball be falling away even more?
But he can move deeper into the oil and go more directly at the pocket with end-over-end roll, and the ball will fall back and set up. That's my point. And Gary can play that shot. He's extremely accurate and can get a heavy roll in that area of the length. That way he doesn't have to hook back and come in late behind the head pin. That's my point. Now, if he's going to hook it back and come in behind the head pin, he has to have more side rotation to kick out the 10.
And he's getting it over here on lane 23.
Well, he's not as deep. He's not as far toward the middle of the lane on 23 as he is. See, that's around the third arrow there. And he's actually getting it back too hard on that lane.
He's right in between. It's a fine line.
A little wry smile there by Gary. It's like, what do you want me to do out there? Come on.
You know, I'm splitting boards as it is here, guys. Pins cooperate.
Two great shot makers here. Both these guys can just continually pound the pocket. Just a matter of whether they do carry the corner pins.
Gary Dickinson cross lane at the four pin. We're halfway through the semifinal match. John Handegard leads by 22. Both players are clean in this frame. We'll have the completion of this match. Earl and I'll be back right then. What you're seeing is a point list for the AMF tournament that we're going to have down in Richmond, Virginia. One senior will qualify off of this point list, and John Handegard has a commanding lead at this point in time, and he's adding to it tonight.
Well, you know, he already has become the oldest senior to win a regular tournament on the PBA Tour at 57, and, you know, he's in great physical condition. He can definitely go down and compete with the kids. He's proven that. First place in the AMF event, I believe, is like $60,000. That's not a bad week's pay.
No, I'd take it.
Johnny, he'll be down there going after it. He's not afraid of anybody. Really heavy roll on that ball. A lot more side rotation there.
And you'll see that Weber Classic here on ESPN, November the 1st. Snow may be flying by then.
It could possibly well be. John again switching balls. He'll go cross lane at the spare, and John won't hook it. Believe me, he'll throw it right at it. What a match that was. 248 to 247. He defeated Gary in match play.
Well, it could still be that way here. Is there kind of still sparring one another? Handegard with about a 20-pin lead right now. 21, exactly. Both players still clean. Dickinson only one strike through six frames. Handegard three, and they were all in a row. Gary had that much hair when he was 20.
Is that one of those glasses full observations, or the glasses half empty?
I don't know. Handegard just keeps pounding him in there, I'll tell you.
It's time for Dickinson to start making his move. 21 pins behind. We're getting late in the frames. You can see him digging those fingers into the holes, try to get maximum rotation. But he fans the ball. He hits it hard at the bottom and then fans it.
He's changed balls, Earl.
Exactly, but watch it. See that fan at the end? It's almost like he wants to roll it hard, but doesn't want it to overhook.
Well, that's his natural release.
Oh, yeah, that's definitely his, but I mean, it's just an observation that he's always done this, but it's like he goes through it, and then he just kind of lets it off his fingers all at once. Look at the oil on the surface of that bowling ball. You can see it shining on the ball.
Yeah, right.
So there's plenty of lane dressing on the lane.
At the two pin, he has no trouble. The spares aren't going to get it done. Hey, Friday night, it's Top Rank Boxing from Lewiston, Maine. We've got a couple of heavyweight rounds. 10-rounder, Shannon Briggs, he's 23-0 with 18 KOs, taking on Sherman Griffith, 17-5 with 13 KOs. That's 9 o'clock Friday night, 6 o'clock out on the coast.
We're going to take a look very quickly at Dickinson's release. Now watch what I'm talking about. See his hand right behind the ball? He lifts up hard right there. Now look, watch him open his hand. Can't quite catch it there, but... if you watch it at home, you'll catch it on some of the subsequent shots because he will just kind of fan it, let his hand, his palm go down toward the floor and just let it kind of come off his hand. Here's another look. It's going to happen very quickly here, but watch his hand as it follows through. The ball is coming off his thumb right here. He lifts hard with the fingers, and then he kind of, see how the hand turns over at the palm to the floor?
That's interesting. For the double. Oh! Knocks that 10 pin out of there.
Time after time after time, John does this. You look at that and you say, oh, this guy's just getting lucky. He doesn't get lucky. He works like a dog. He earns every one of those, and that's how he likes to roll the ball. He doesn't want to overdo it. He just wants enough to get the job done. He's asking for a re-rack on lane 23.
John, with 11 senior championships, has made over $316,000 on the senior tour. He just goes on and on and on.
And, you know, he sets his goals higher and higher. He's never satisfied. He's kind of like you were.
He's also, like, as I say, so dedicated. This is all he cares about. He loves to play this game. It's not work for John. It's something he loves to do. It's his life.
Nancy's just used to it, huh?
Well, if you're going to marry a pro bowler, you better get used to it. Because
she's probably watched a lot of practice games, too.
Oh, my, I guess.
Gary has to strike now. Trailing by 42 pins, he's got to take it off the sheet. Will it get up? Nope, the 258. He just never could get it lined up just right. Never got up to the hill on this right lane.
Well, that gives us the match we're kind of
looking for,
you might say. The dream match, you might say. Tommy Evans, the tournament leader, undefeated from the number one position against a guy that is considered by many the best senior player in the world, John Handegard.
Well, I mean, with very good reason.
No question. He has the credentials. Not only has he won one this year, but I believe he has 3 seconds. And he, as I mentioned, won a stop on the regular PBA Tour this year up in Washington State. He's been a factor in almost every time he enters an event, he's a factor.
He's leading in points. Tommy's leading in average.
Tommy has high average for the year. Where was that, he says.
Yeah, well, he can move out and get that one to go to the pocket. You know, he just never got lined up on lane 24.
You know, we watched Gary in practice, and we watched all five players in practice, but Gary seemed to be playing quite well around that second arrow. The oil must have moved drastically for him to get in between third and fourth arrow.
Well, we could see that with Winger in the last match. And,
right.
You know, that his ball was just overreacting something fierce. Is he going to fall over? Yes.
They always fall, Mike.
Yeah, right, but it doesn't
matter.
They
don't count.
Well, he switches back balls. Doesn't matter on that lane. He can strike with either ball on that lane. 206, a clean game. Just not enough to beat Mr. Handegard. The handyman.
Very handy at this game.
Wonder if he switched balls here to practice in the 10th.
I don't think so. I think he's comfortable where he's at. He just wants to make sure he's got the right line. And that's not a good time to have that happen. Even though it doesn't affect the outcome of the match, it's not a good confidence builder going up against Tommy Evans. And I think he wanted to strike there so he could try maybe moving a little bit here and there. Make sure he was lined up perfectly.
Well, you know, in the eighth frame, he kind of had, it was in a little deeper. It seems the ball fell back and love tapped the 10. Maybe he made a slight move there in the 10th frame. He's going back to that 10 pin. Dickinson, $4,000, third place finish. Final score, Handegard 224, Dickinson 206, rather. We'll be back with championship frame right after this. And now it's time for championship frame, a review of our previous three matches. And in the opening match, Ron Winger started fast, had relatively easy time, and this kind of locked it up here in the eighth frame, Earl.
This is the strike that kind of put the defeats on Denny Torgerson, because after that five-bagger to start the match, it was just hang on for Ron Winger.
And the final score, 232 to 187. Winger defeats Torgerson. Gave him the opportunity to move on against Gary Dickinson. This is the sixth frame.
Well, this is when things kind of went the other way for Ron Winger. This is the sixth frame, and this is kind of the open that did him in. Gary Dickinson got off to a hot start, and Winger, the big, big split. You can see his reaction to that. Of course, Dickinson sitting there saying, hey, I like this.
And 224 to 142. Well, Ron has done better. Handegard, third match, eighth frame, working on a strike.
Working on a strike after Dickinson had struck in the previous frame, so the pressure's on, and Handegard wants to put this one away. Dickinson, no easy match to defeat, and his reaction on that one was, all right, I love it.
Well, even with the open in the 10th, 224 to 206, that sets up the match we're looking for.
Tommy Evans, he's won twice this year. Handegard's looking to win twice. Stay tuned. Well, two seniors have had great years this year. One of them is going to have a real inside track to Senior Player of the Year after this game. We'll see which one. John Handegard, again, gets to finish on the lane that he wanted to finish on last time, but he did open in the 10th frame. So there's got to be a question mark the first time he comes up on lane 24. And the 10-pin start, same as last game.
Nothing unique. There have been a lot of 10-pins this week. Spare shooting hasn't been a problem. All the players I talked to and everybody I watched said that spares were fairly easy. The surface reacts very true, so the guys are just rolling them cross lane in the oil, letting it skid into the 10.
Just like that, no trouble. Tommy Evans, our first look at him. Now, he goes rather straight, Earl. Is he going to run into the same problems that Dickinson did?
Well, he throws a different type of rotation than Dickinson. Dickinson rolls it fairly straight as far as the trajectory of the ball is concerned, but it's a rolling ball. Tommy Evans likes to spin it. So watch the release here. He gets around the side of the ball a little bit. That's how he keeps it online. See the spin, the rotation? So he gets it farther down the lane before it grips, so he has an advantage when the lanes break down. For him, he's better off if they're hooking in the first part of the lane because he can skid it through it, and it gives him an advantage over the guys that roll the ball. Their ball tends to roll early. Here's a look at the side, from the side, at the style of Tommy Evans. Look at this, the five-step approach. One, two, get it in motion. The good arm swing here. Now the long, he's right there where he wants to be. A little bit higher than you might want the ball to be, but look at the long slide. Stays down with the shot.
And for you fans at home, we're giving scores at 10.
Perfect elbow.
Perfect elbow. 10, 30, and 50 past the hour on ESPN. Trying for the quick double. Hit a little weak.
Well, those are the kind of shots right there that can be the difference between winning and losing a tournament like this. Now, if he'd have got the break and carried that, that puts pressure on Handegard early on in the match.
Right.
And, of course, right now, Tommy Evans says, well, you know, bad break for me, good break for Handegard. Tommy, a good spare shooter, switching balls here to a shiny surface, won't hook, throw it right at him.
No trouble. Handegard studying lane 24. I would think that he's going to get in a little deeper here than that 4-6.
I wonder if he just made a bad shot there rather than he's got a bad reaction. It's hard to tell. John very seldom makes a bad shot, but the concentration on his face, the steady head. Good arm swing here. Oh, what a great release that was, Mike.
And it's CFA College Football, Thursday night, September 21st at 8 o'clock. It's the North Carolina Tar Heels going into Louisville. That's Cardinal Stadium in Kentucky. Be sure to join us. 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 5 out on the coast.
Well, the shoe is on the other foot. A chance for John Handegard to take the early lead. Tommy Evans on that light hit left a 7-pin on this lane. Big John, good rotation, perfect hit, got them all.
Well,
Tommy just may be thinking, I got to have my average to have a chance against you. 248 is average from the lead spot. He might have to shoot at least that against Handegard. Handegard's ready.
Tommy. Flush. Talk to him about an injury that he had earlier.
I own a pro shop, and picking up a ball one time, it fell backwards, and I pulled a tendon that runs down your thumb there. And throwing a 16-pound ball was hurting my wrist most of the time, so I decided to drop down to 15 pounds to see if it would relieve the pressure. It has relieved the pressure quite a bit, but in doing so, I've been bowling better, and I may never go back to 16.
Well, sometimes a bad thing turns into a good thing.
That's a good point for the seniors that are watching this telecast, too, because you don't have to throw a 16-pound ball. You can enjoy it a lot more with a 15 or a 14.
And he gets that 5-pin out of there this time. sends a message to Handegard that, hey, I'm ready to play too.
Well, there's a lot at stake here. Of course, the difference in the prize money is $4,500, $10,000 to the winner, the fact that you're the champion. But much more than that, Mike, as we've talked about many times already, is maybe you're watching the player of the year on the senior tour at this moment. The winner of this match could very well be that.
Good shot, but leaves that 10-pin. Pat Sinello, the proprietor of Woodside Lanes, been here 5 years.
He loves it, too. He does a great job with this, and they have a great pro-am. The kids, they give them trophies for winning their different divisions, and they have, I don't know, 8 or 10 different divisions. And the kids love it. Well, I'll tell you what, they just show up here in flocks.
Some kind of sound coming through on a radio somewhere. John heard it, but nothing breaks his concentration. Moves over to the left lane. Back to work. Needs a strike to set up the opportunity for a double.
That good push away, the free arm swing, good extension. Careful.
Oh, he got a break.
Oh, my.
Nice break there.
Well, maybe that radio did bother him a little bit. Might have made him think a little bit about something else. Here's a good look at that pin action. The Jersey squasher, the high Brooklyn hit, got all the pins pushing everything to the right. Last one out the 10 pin. John's reaction is, oh, look out.
Well, he'll take it, though, I'll tell you what.
Well, that let's see how Tommy Evans reacts to that.
Flush, boy.
Well, I described Tommy Evans one time as a little bulldog. He gets out there and he grabs hold of this thing. He's thinking, I got my teeth into this tournament. I led it. I'm holding on for dear life, and you got to grab me and get me off it because I'm not going to let go. You got to beat Tommy Evans. He doesn't beat himself.
Up 11 pins in this match, working on 3 in a row. Going to lane 23, the lane he's chosen to finish on.
And the more the lanes hook, the better he likes it. You can see how he skids the ball down the lane with that side rotation. He doesn't lift it hard, just kind of lets it off his hand with a spinning rotation, and it skids a long way, then grips the lane.
Well, John better keep going.
Two very accurate, consistent releases in both players. Here's another look at Tommy Evans. You can see the high backswing. But watch how easily the ball comes off his hand. Just gets on the side a little bit, rotates around the side, doesn't lift it hard, just kind of lets it fall off his hand. Looks like he's playing shuffleboard a little bit. Look at the rotation on that one. That one had some energy on it.
I tell you what, I think this is a very big shot coming up because it not only gets him close to even in the match if he strikes here, but, you know, he had an errant shot the last time on this lane. He has to have some doubt in his mind about what the lane's going to do.
Good point. John is so confident, though, in his ability to make good shots. I don't think he's going to make a lot of moves here. He'll just go up there and make a better shot. That ball had to have gotten away from him. I don't think the lanes change that quickly, that drastically, from one shot to the next. Kind of a little more concentration, take some time. More ball speed, Mike.
Oh, left the 10 pin. Very professional shot. But
very good shot. He looked like he just got his legs into that one more to help him get a little more energy and a little more ball speed, and couldn't get the back end he wanted to carry the 10. Cross lane spares are just as important as strikes right now to stay in this match. Only at this point 12 pins down, so it's anybody's match yet. Tommy Evans up and ready. He almost got that one in the channel. You see that?
Oh, it's just no problem. No problem. No problem.
Never a doubt.
Evans, total concentration.
What a great place to have a bowling tournament. Naples, Florida, great beaches, just beautiful here.
Going 5 in a row.
He's going to make his average.
Lynn says, keep it up. One more, honey. 22 pins ahead.
Yeah.
Well, you can see why he's 3-0 from the top spot, averaging 248.
Well, that's all John Handegard can shoot if he strikes out is 248, and that's Tommy Evans' average. So I think John, if he sees Evans get this one, he's going to get up there thinking, I know I got to have them all. There's just no doubt. John is right now thinking, this is getting away from me. He's looking back at a couple of 10 pins.
And that's it.
A little more ball speed there.
Ooh,
a little more ball and a little more hit. 9 pin.
15-pound ball in the third arrow. Tommy Evans, solid 9. He says,
well,
how does that happen?
What, you know what the last pin down was, don't you?
7, what, or 4.
4. He had the 4-9 briefly, and what a turnaround that would have been if it had stood up.
Well, it gives Handegard some life. He's down by 21. Tommy switches balls at the 9-pin. Hits a dead flush.
It's amazing how well these seniors can perform under this kind of pressure. And you know they're both feeling a lot of pressure out there, but they're still making tremendous shots when they need to make them. John Handegard knows he needs them all, starting right now.
Has to hurry, and it does. Talk to John about how important Senior Player of the Year is to him.
It's very important. It's a goal that I've been striving for all year, and I'll tell you what, it's going to be tough because we have several players in contention, most of whom are on the show tonight.
Well, right now, trailing by 21, this is the most important shot of the week for him, right? All
the
games he's
has to be. Yep. He has to strike here to have any chance at all to win the match. And if he does strike here, Tommy Evans gets up on the right-hand lane thinking, hey, he can still shoot 240. I don't have that much yet. Good shot. Set up for him, but not enough.
Leaves the 4 pin.
Well, the most he can come up with now is 228, and that would mean some help from Tommy Evans. Tommy Evans would have to make a major mistake. You know, I talked to Tommy Evans briefly about this. Here's we take a look at the pin action as he leaves the 4 pin. But look at the little wiggle he gets here as it comes out of the channel there. That's the 2 pin. But I talked to Tommy a little bit. I said, what does Bowler of the Year mean to you? And he says, well, I want to win this tournament, but I'm not sure I want to be Player of the Year because of the added responsibilities and demands on your time. That's kind of an interesting observation there. He said he kind of values his privacy, and he knows that if he is Player of the Year, you know, he wants to win this tournament, obviously, very much, but it could put him in the position where he is Player of the Year with 3 wins, and he's not sure he wants that. That was a surprise to me.
9th frame. Fall back. Oh, my goodness.
Hello.
4-7-10, and this is not over yet. If he misses this...
Well, he can still... He can't be shut out. He can shoot 235 if he misses this. So, the possibility, if he just gets 2 of them, and that's a smart thing to do, in my opinion, is take the 2, and, you know, he could pick it up, and the match would basically be, you know, in that position again of winning just with a mark, but... Just take the 2, get over and get your double and get this over with. He's going for it. Got a chance. No.
Well, right now he's going at a 225 pace.
That's the only real mistake he's made in 9 shots. The others
pressure
are all right there.
Pressure did
I'm
that?
I'm not sure. I'm really not sure. You know, Tommy's he's a very tough competitor. He doesn't very often give you a chance to get back into the match when
there it is.
Kind of a lead, and there's a look at it.
7 pins the difference.
Handegard can't wait to get up on that approach. If Evans doesn't put him away, Handegard's going to be right there ready, boy. This is high also.
Wow, he broke it down. Handegard's still alive. Leaves the 6-10. He stood up as soon as he let that go.
Yeah, he got a little quicker to the foul line. And, you know, remember on lane 23 in the 8th frame, he almost had the 4-9. Then he gets up on the 9th on lane 24, hits the nose, comes back, hits the nose on 23. Here's another look at it. And as you say, he came right up with this ball. The ball's coming off his hand. He's coming up. But look how he fans it. Look at his hand at the top. He doesn't want to lift it. He wants just to let it slide. Spares are important right now, more important than anything else.
Well, he's got it.
Well, it means that Handegard will need a double.
Has a chance.
But he needs 2 strikes to win.
And that's all John is asking for. He didn't think, after he didn't strike in the 9th frame, he didn't think he had a chance.
That's correct. I tell you what. John has only missed once on the right-hand lane, so I like his chances.
Strike for 225. 223, so count really doesn't matter.
2 strikes to win. Sit here and watch, just like you. 2 strikes to win.
Evans head down, Handegard up, about his business.
He's 3-for-4 with one 10-pin on this lane. Very quickly to the foul line.
Oh, he got the 10.
Well,
he didn't think it was going to carry.
I know, and you know, it means so much to John. Here's a look at that ball going down the lane. Good rotation. The ball turns into the pocket at that point, but look at the deflection. It doesn't really hit that hard, but he got just enough of it to kick the 10.
He wants a re-rack, asked Rich Weber, our tournament director.
This is his second re-rack of the match.
Well, right now, this is the match.
This is the match. This is maybe bowler of the year.
One ball.
One ball.
Well, we'll shut up and watch it.
He doesn't like this rack either. You can see his reaction here. Looks good to me, Mike. There's 10 of them. That's all you can ask for. Here we go. For the tournament.
Will it carry?
No, it's high.
High. Evans has won. Evans has won. Handegard is mad.
Handegard is upset with himself because he cut that shot off. He didn't get it off his hand the way he normally does. Didn't stay with it. He got a little quick and hit up on the ball, and that's why it hooked up high.
Well, Evans has won. We'll be back to talk to him right after this. Stay with us. Brought to you by the professionals of Century 21 Real Estate. Whether you're buying or selling your home, you can lean on us. And there's a very emotional champion, Tommy Evans. Are you breathing, Tom?
Hardly, Mike. Hardly, boy. This means so much. It's just, after the year that I've had and everything, this is just quite a climax. I just don't know what to say.
Well, to add to that climax, we've got Pat Sinello here, the proprietor. He has both a check and a trophy for you.
Tommy, I'd like to present this. You did a fantastic job and made it really exciting that last game. It's nice to see a Florida boy do it for us. Congratulations.
Thank you, Pat. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the people in Naples, Mr. Sinello, all the fans here. Thank you very much. I have had a wonderful week. I've had the most memorable week in my life. Thank you very much.
All right, for Earl Anthony, this is Mike Durbin thanking everyone for watching and saying so long from Naples, Florida. Be sure to join us next week from St. Petersburg, Clearwater, as that's the St. Petersburg, Clearwater Senior Open. That's Tuesday, 9 o'clock Eastern Time.